Well, I'd like to welcome you out to our online ministry of the Open Bible Baptist Church. And this is the last online ministry for the year 2022. And it's hard to imagine that we're at the end of another year. And the Lord has blessed us and He's encouraged us. And I trust that as you've looked to the Lord, that you've found much blessing and much encouragement this past year. And I would like to invite you to turn to number 129 in our song books. We're going to sing, and it's all because of the cross, and it says, at the cross, 129.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die, would He
all the day, because Jesus made all the difference. Because Jesus went to the cross, He laid His life down for us, He rose again the third day, and He offers us eternal life in Him. Let's bow together in prayer. Father, tonight we thank You for this time around Your word. We thank You for this past year as we reflect on the blessings, the challenges, the guidance, the wisdom, the leading of the Holy Spirit. We thank You, Lord, for Your direction in this past year. And Father, as we look forward to another year, we pray, Father, that You would continue to lead us and guide us by Thy hand. Father, we look forward to the coming of Jesus. Your word declares that He is coming again. Oh, Father, we pray that we would be watchful, that we would be waiting, that we would be anticipating His return. And Father, that we would be living in the light of that truth. And Lord, we pray that You would bless each one tonight. We pray if there's any tuning in that has never trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, to know for sure their sins are forgiven, to know for sure they're on their way to heaven. And Father, we pray tonight that tonight would be the time they would come by faith alone and received the finished work of Jesus for them. We thank you, Lord, that it was at the cross that, Father, he bore our sin. And, Father, all the burden has been rolled away. And, Lord, we thank you that our eyes have been opened, that now we can see. And now we can have joy as we travel through this life. We pray, Father, that you would guide us now in your word. We ask that you would be with those that are going through some various sicknesses, Lord. We know there have been many that have experienced illness. And there's some in hospital. There's others, Lord, that are going through times of treatment for different diseases. And Lord, we pray that you would give grace, give help, give strength, give sense of your peace. And the Father, as we think of your peace, we'll be looking at that tonight. The peace of Christ, the Holy Spirit of God who gives us the gift of peace. We pray, Father, that you would cause us to dwell on your peace, not on the false peace that the world has to offer, but on that which is true, that which is eternal. For it is in Jesus' name we pray and we ask. Amen. I'd like to invite you to take your Bibles, please, and turn with me to the book of Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah chapter 9. We're back in verse 6, concluding this verse as we've been looking at the last number of Wednesday evenings together. It tells us in Isaiah 9 in the 6th verse, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." And the Lord bless the reading of his word. And we take great refuge and great confidence in the word of God. We know that the Bible is God's word. It is God-breathed, and it is a living word. The scriptures tell us that it is alive, able to pierce into our hearts, the Spirit of God able to teach us and illuminate the scriptures so that we might have proper understanding. We know the scriptures teach us that there are individuals in the world that cannot understand. If we do not know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, how hard would it be for us to understand these things which are spiritual, as recorded in the Word of God? "But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned." And so those that are not in Jesus do not understand the things of the Word of God, of the Spirit of God. Certainly, it's a foolish teaching that the world will say as we go to the Bible for wisdom, as we go to God's word for direction in our lives. "But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." And so we are to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He desires to teach us from his word, and we can be thankful that we have the Spirit of God indwelling us. And as we think tonight on this last point in verse number 6, we're thinking of the name of the Lord Jesus, the name of the one, of the child that would be born, speaking of his humanity, speaking of the one who, the Son, who would be given, speaking of his deity, looking at his name, as the authority shall be upon his shoulder, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And we were looking at the name last time together, the Everlasting Father. He is the Eternal One. He is the Self-Existing One. He is the Great I Am. And he is the Lord Jesus, the one who came. And the scripture says to us, he is the Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace. We know tonight the world is looking for peace. They're looking in all different directions. They're searching for peace. Souls are searching, trying to find peace in one area or another. And they turn one corner and try to find peace there. And and aren't satisfied, and the devil has another something for them to be able to turn their eyes on. Oh, how the devil wants to turn the eyes of souls away from the one who is the Prince of Peace, the one who can bring peace to the troubled soul. Jesus says, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He is desiring to give rest for the weary soul, and he offers that rest through the sacrifice of himself, through his precious blood, which is able to offer us forgiveness of sins. And so there's so many looking for peace today. They won't find true peace outside of Jesus. And we can think in times in our lives we've looked for peace somewhere else other than Jesus. We've found disappointment. We've found temporal satisfaction, but not peace. We've found discouragement. We've found even depression. All of this is found outside of Jesus. But when we turn to him, we find that he is peace, and he is the Prince of Peace. He is the one who indwells us. And so the scriptures talk about peace in different ways. In the Old Testament, it talks about peace as a calm or a tranquility that an individual has, or a group or a nation would experience. In the New Testament, the Greek word is often used to describe the objective of the New Testament local church: peace and spiritual harmony brought about by an individual relationship to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have peace with God. The scriptures teach us of this peace. Now, it speaks of Jesus coming as the Prince of Peace. He came, we know, the first time was born in Bethlehem. And he came unto his own received him not. And he, we know that there are many that rejected him, some that received him. But ultimately, in his first coming, it was one where he was led as a lamb to the slaughter. It was one where he came to die for us on the cross. The Bible says he's coming again. He's coming as the judge. But he's coming as the one who is going to set up his kingdom of peace, of righteousness, and of judgment, one where he will rule and reign. And he will bind Satan 1,000 years. I want us to think of the peace then that we experience in the Lord Jesus. It tells us, first of all, in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 10. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Now, there's a word we find here which is perhaps the opposite of peace, and that is to be at enmity, or to be an enemy of God. And the scriptures make it very clear that before we came into a relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ, we were enemies. We were enemies of God. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, so shall we be saved by his life. And so this speaks of the relationship, this speaks of the transaction that has taken place, and that we have believed on his Son, the Lord Jesus. We were enemies at one point to God, but because of the Lord Jesus and his sacrifice and our acceptance of faith in him, we have been reconciled. We have been brought into a right relationship with God through his Son, and we will be saved through his life. We were appointed unto death at one point. Now we're appointed unto life because we've been reconciled. The accounts have been settled. Our sin debt has been paid and applied to our account because we by faith have responded to the gospel message of the Lord Jesus. And it says in chapter 5 and verse 8, but God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so we're so thankful that the Lord Jesus loved us where we were. He saw us in our need. He knew that we needed to be reconciled to God. There was no other way for us to find that peace, to find reconciliation, apart from Jesus offering himself as an atonement, as a sacrifice for our sins. And not only so, it says in verse 11, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. And if your sins have been forgiven tonight, you can go to bed and rest easy, because we're safe and secure in the arms of Jesus. There is no other security that is like that which the Lord Jesus offers us. The world will try to offer some kind of peace and security, but we know that in this world there's trouble. In this world there's disappointment. In Jesus there's hope. In Jesus there's security. And of course, those verses that the Lord Jesus said in John 10, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. And so when we think of the Lord Jesus as being the Prince of Peace, he has the power to breathe peace into our lives because of his sacrifice, so that we could be made right with God because of the work on the cross, so that we might have his peace and his hope inside of us. And that's where we want to kind of move toward in our message tonight. And that is, of course, the Spirit of God who lives in us. And it's impossible for us to know the peace of Christ if we don't have the Spirit of Christ in us. There's a lot of confusion, we know, in the world today that talks about the Spirit. Some say, well, we can't be truly saved unless we're baptized by the Spirit. Others say we can't be truly saved unless we have some kind of special gifts of the Holy Spirit. And then there's others that say we can't truly be saved unless we're filled with the Holy Spirit. And then some say, well, we can lose our salvation. We can be filled with the Spirit at one point, and the Spirit can leave us. And there's a lot of confusion today when it comes to the ministry of the Holy and the person of the Holy Spirit of God. The Bible tells us, yes, we can be filled by the Holy Spirit. Yes, we can have the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We have the fruit of the Holy Spirit. We have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But one thing that I'm very thankful for, along with all of those other things, is the sealing of the Holy Spirit. That we have been sealed, the scripture says, unto the day of redemption. That means that we cannot lose the Holy Spirit of God. We cannot lose our salvation. It says if we know Jesus Christ, we have everlasting life. We have eternal life. And we just read the verse in John that says that we can never be plucked out of the Father's hand. And so there are many Christians today that are struggling because they've been taught that they can lose the salvation that they have so freely received from Jesus. They have been taught that their salvation is based upon their works now that they're saved. They may have come onto the Lord Jesus by faith, but then they're taught that their works keep them saved. Our works cannot save us, and our works cannot keep us saved. We are saved by grace through faith, and we are kept by the power of his hand. We are kept by his infinite mighty power, never able to be taken away from the Father's hand. Jesus says, I and my Father are one. And so what a hope we have tonight, that we don't have to think that one day we're going to lose that eternal free gift of eternal life that we've received. No, we are eternally secure in him. And so there are many Bible verses that back up this teaching. And it's important for us to open God's word and read it, what it says, and then claim the promises of the word of God. Then notice with me, as we look at the Holy Spirit and his ministry, it tells us in chapter 16 of the Gospel of John, in verse 7, Jesus says this, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, that it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. The Comforter he's speaking of is the Holy Spirit. And the Comforter is the very Spirit of Christ. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the one that comes and he lives inside of us. And Jesus says it was important, it was necessary for him, it was expedient for him to go away. Because he said, I go unto my Father, and he said, I'm going to send another one of the same kind, the Comforter, who's going to live and be with you forever. And in verse 13, he says to his disciples, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Now the Holy Spirit of God is the author of the very Word of God that we have before us, the living Word of God. And so he breathed through these individuals to write exactly, to have recorded exactly God's message for us, so we can know with assurance that this is the infallible, true Word of God, the very God-breathed message that he has for us. And he says, he will guide you into all truth. And there's an aspect of that in which he is continuing to guide us today into all truth. He will never lead us contrary to what God's word teaches us. He will always lead us in accordance with God, what God has said in his word. Now, will he lead us into practical areas in our lives? Decisions that we need to make? Can we trust the Holy Spirit when it comes to these practical areas? Absolutely we can. God has a will and he has a purpose for each and every one of us. And he desires us to be yielded to the Holy Spirit of God, so that we would be filled and that we would be controlled by him, that we would sense his leading, sense his direction and his power and his guidance in our lives when it comes to these practical areas of God's will for us. And so we need to trust him and we need to lean upon him for guidance and for control. Notice another area is the fruit of the Spirit. We know this passage in Galatians chapter 5 and verse number 22 and 23 says these words, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. For if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. You know, we can live in the Spirit. We can have the Holy Spirit of God indwelling us, but we may not be walking after the Spirit. That doesn't mean we've lost our salvation, but it does mean that we're walking in a carnal state. We're walking in a way which is after the flesh and not after the Spirit. And it's a dangerous thing to walk after the things of the flesh. It's a dangerous thing to walk after the things that we've been saved from. We know we have that old nature within us, and he's going to want to always pull us toward the things that go contrary to God's word, the things that we once lived for, the things that we've been saved out of. And we need God's power and his Spirit to help us. You know, we're living in exceeding sinful and wicked days. The Bible says that the times will come in which the days will be like unto the days of Noah. And we're living in days like unto the days of Noah. We're living in days like unto the days of Lot, when he lived in Sodom, and God judged Sodom and Gomorrah for their sin. We're living in days like the days of the judges in the Old Testament, when the Bible says that everyone did that which was right in his own eyes. We're living in days when the Apostle Paul said that there will be times when they will have no fear of God before their eyes. And where is the fear of God today in the world? In our Western world, it doesn't seem to be here at all. We thank God that there are souls still being saved, and there are souls being saved in other parts of the world today where there is a fear of God. How important it is to fear the Lord. There used to be a fear of God in Canada and in other places. There was at least a knowledge of God, a knowledge of who Jesus was, and a fear of God, and a respect for authority, and a respect for parents. But those things have gone by the wayside, and those are the marks of what the Bible says will be the last days. In the last days, perilous times shall come, it says. And those are the characteristics. How important it is for us then to have the Holy Spirit of God guiding and leading and directing us and controlling us and empowering us and helping us, because the tempter is waving all kinds of enticing things for us to go after. He wants to lead us astray. Do we have the fruit of the Spirit tonight flowing through us? Where we don't, we can ask the Lord for help. We can seek his cleansing power in our lives, and we can find ourselves restored to him, brought back into a right fellowship with him, so that we can walk with him and have that love, joy, peace, the peace of Christ, the Prince of Peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. All of these the Lord desires for us. We need to be willing to submit ourselves to him and to the authority of the Holy Spirit of God in our lives. Well, the Lord Jesus, the Prince of Peace in us, desires to bring unity, and he helps the local church in that endeavor. As he says in chapter 4 of Ephesians in verse 1, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. He says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Do you know that the Holy Spirit of God desires to unite us around one person, and that person is the Lord Jesus Christ? The Holy Spirit of God desires to unite us around one word, and it is the holy and infallible Word of God and the authority of the Word of God over our lives. And so when we unite ourselves around the person of Christ, when we unite ourselves around the authority of the Word of God, we will then unite ourselves together as a body of believers, united around the center of the person of Christ. Now, will there be differences in the body of Christ? The Bible says not all is the hearing, not all is the seeing. The arms, the feet, all different parts of the body of the Lord Jesus. And with the body comes different personalities, different interests, different responses to situations. And we need to be forbearing, the scripture says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. And we think of the forbearing relationship that comes in the home. And perhaps no one knows us best as our parents did as they raised us, but then as our spouse does as we live in the home. And there is much forbearing and love and forgiving that ought to be in the home. Are there going to be times of difficulty? Yes, there are. Does Satan want those times of difficulty to cause, to rain a cloud over the home? No, he doesn't. He desires for there to be forgiveness. And we're so thankful that we can forgive one another. And the Lord Jesus can forgive us when we step out of line. He is so good to us, and we can be so thankful for husbands and wives who desire to forgive one another and desire to keep moving forward, because Christ is greater than any difference that can come into the home or into a marriage. And the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ and the cause of the home and what he's doing in the lives of children is far greater than any difficulty that can come, and we can be so thankful for forgiveness that is found between a husband and a wife. And then in the church, how often does Christ forgive the bride, his bride, the church? And he cleanses her, and he purifies her. What is he looking to do in chapter 5 and verse 25? Husbands, love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. That's what he's looking to do to the church. And he says, now, husbands, you love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. What kind of love is that? That selfless, sacrificial love. We're coming into another year. May it be that our homes would be filled with love. Our homes would be filled with forgiveness. Our homes would be filled with peace, because we know the Prince of Peace. We know the peace of God, which passeth all understanding. We have come into a relationship with Christ, and we have the peace of God. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, and we know the peace of God. And it says in Philippians chapter 4, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And so we can be so thankful that we have the peace of Christ that passes all understanding, and he desires to work in and through us. I want to go to another verse as we reflect on the peace, the Prince of Peace, the one who has come, the one who rules and reigns in our hearts by faith. But then if you take your Bibles and turn to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 37. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 37. And he says this, for yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. For yet a little while, and he that shall come and will not tarry. You know, the Lord Jesus has been gone into heaven a little while. We say, well, 2,000 years is such a long period of time. No, it has just been a little while. It has just been a little while since he walked the face of this earth. It's just been a little while since he caused the dead to rise. It's just been a little while since he called the lame to get up and walk and the blind to be able to see. It's just been a little while since he died on the cross, was buried, and rose again. The devil would want us to think it has been a long while. The devil would want us to think it's been such a long while that how can those promises be fulfilled? Oh, it has just been a little while. The scripture says that with the Lord, one day is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. It has just been a little while. And the Bible says, for yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. The Bible says that when he comes, it's going to be a moment, a twinkling of an eye. It's going to be without a moment's notice, and it's going to happen so fast, and we're going to be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. The Bible says that the Prince of Peace is coming. The one who came the first time is the Lamb, the one who rose in glory and is seated at the right hand of the Father, the one who intercedes for us, the one who indwells us by his Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, the peace of Christ, knowing the peace of Christ in our hearts, the one who desires to allow peace to flow in our hearts like a river. The Bible says the Prince of Peace is coming, and he that will come, shall come, will come, and will not tarry. And the Bible says he's coming, and we need to trust God in his word. If he may even come before this year is out, are we ready to meet him? Are we anticipating his return? The King is coming. The King is coming. We've heard that song before. I've heard the trumpet sounding, and his face I at last shall see. The King is coming. He's coming for me, and he's coming for you. Are you ready to meet him tonight? I trust you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. I trust you know the Prince of Peace, and that you can say with all certainty, I know my sins are forgiven. I know I'm on my way to heaven, and I'm so thankful for the peace of Christ, which lives and abides in me today, that I can walk with him and he with me. Father, thank you for your word tonight. We pray, Father, as we conclude this year that you have given us, we thank you for the various Bible studies that we have surveyed, and Lord, that you have taught us and led us and equipped us. Father, thank you for challenging us. Forgive us, Lord, for so many areas and where we've failed this past year. We thank you for your cleansing power. We thank you for the saving power. And Father, we thank you for that sustaining power. And Lord, that one day we're going to be in that resurrected power. And one day our bodies are going to be changed to be like thy body in glory. And Father, we pray that you would now part us with thy blessing. We pray that you would bless each one that's tuned in. For we give thee thanks and praise, for it's in Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. I want to thank you for tuning in. Take care, each one, and Lord willing, we look forward to seeing you in 2023.